Good evening, everybody. I give you a warm welcome here at Forum Stadtpark, and also welcome to all our listeners at Radio Helsinki and to our viewers at Octo TV and Elevate Media Channel. Welcome to our event with the title Everything is Connected. With this event, we'll try to bring together all the different topical strands of the Elevate Festival that we focused on during the last years and also this year. We'll discuss how everything is connected from the socio-ecological area with climate change and resource depletion, big everything and all these things, food, agriculture and media, technology. We'll discuss the role of social movements and grassroots initiatives, etc. And we'll also definitely have some looks at the future and how it's possibly going to turn out with the different scenarios we might experience. Okay, I'm very happy to have such nice panelists up here, and I'll introduce them. And I'll start with Amy Goodman. I'm so happy that you finally made it to Graz and Elevate Festival. Amy Goodman is, of course, as you will all know, the host of Democracy Now!, a great independent global news hour, which started actually out in 1996 as a very small radio program, as far as I understand, and is now broadcast on over 1,300 stations, TV and radio all around the world, which is pretty amazing. And I'm so grateful for what you guys are doing. It's a big inspiration. You can watch Democracy Now! On Octo every day and also hear it at Radio Helsinki in Graz. Okay, there's Nafeez. Some of you guys will definitely know him because he was already there here at Elevate two times in 2011 and 2012. In 2011, we did actually the world premiere of a film based on his work entitled The Crises of Civilization, which sums everything up, what he's working on, because he's working on the connections of all the various crises, and used this term to describe the whole situation we're in. He's a writer and an international security analyst, and yeah, he writes for a lot of interesting publications that I love, and also especially for The Guardian, where he has his own blog. It's called Earth Inside, and I really recommend it to all you guys that you can follow this. Okay, there's Silke Helfrich. Thank you. Welcome, Nafeez. Silke Helfrich, next to Nafeez. She's also very important for the Elevate Festival. She really helped us out a lot in 2008 when we did a festival with the title Elevate the Commons, at a time where most people in the German-speaking world didn't know what it is, including most speakers we invited. So Silke had I had a constant email conversation with Silke. How are we going to do this? Who can I invite next? And so on and so on. So Silke is, at that time, she was the commons activist in the German-speaking world, and she still is. But she has help from other people, also from Graz. For example, my colleague Brigitte Grazwald was inspired a lot, and now you have some help. She has a great book over here, very big work with a lot of pages and lots of interesting contributions.
513.
For the first time here in Graz at Elevate Festival is Friederike Habermann. She's an economist, historian, political scientist and activist, and she was active in social movements for quite a long time, and her most recent book with the title Geschichte wird gemacht, Etappen des globalen Widerstands, History is Made, Stages of Global Resistance, was recently released, I think, and it covers, from her subjective point of view, the development of the anti-globalization movement. Please give a warm welcome to Friederike. And last but not least, here's Felix Stalder. He already participated in the previous panel. He's a professor for digital culture and network theories at the Zurich University of the Arts. And he's also a member of the World Information Institute in Vienna. He investigates the interrelationships between society, culture, and digital technologies, and focuses on new forms of cultural production and autonomous social institutions. Please give a warm welcome. Okay, what we're going to start with is an analysis of the current status quo we're all in. We know we're in quite a deep crisis. We could call it a multiple socio-ecological crisis. As Nafeez coined the term, the crisis of civilization, with a term that is also used by indigenous people, I think. So it's shared, a shared term, and we'll use it to start out with, and Nafeez will give us a short overview what's going on in the world and how the different crises are connected.
Okay, so I mean, I don't think that there's any need to kind of go really in depth into like a lot of the stuff that we know is happening. We're all aware that climate change is a real problem, that it's out of control. We know that there are issues with energy depletion and there are issues with our dependence on really dirty types of fossil fuels like shale gas and tar sands and oil shale and all that stuff. We know that our economy has been in a recession since 2008, and that even though it's supposedly been in a temporary recovery, it's actually still really, for actually most people in the world, in a real recession. You know, unprecedented unemployment rates, you know, rampant inequality, so on and so forth. And obviously, we also know that there is a global food crisis, which again, you know, despite the fact that food prices have been hovering and tapering off, and there's been, you know, people are sometimes predicting that, well, the food prices might go down this year or next year and it's going to be okay. But ultimately, they've been on a record level high for the last few years, since around 2008, actually. And they've been fluctuating since then. And, you know, that's impacted on the ground in people's lives in a very, very real way. So, you know, kind of all these things, you know, we know what's happening. But I think, I guess as a recap for those of you who are familiar with the kind of stuff that I've been talking about with crisis of civilization and that whole framework of looking at things, is that I think it's really important that when we look at these crises, we do not look at them as isolated or separate problems that kind of occur in a silo. And there is an unfortunate tendency, which is partly to do with the nature of our science, which is understandable, but science has taken us on this kind of path of extreme disciplinary fragmentation, where it's like you have to specialize and you have to go really deep into stuff. But the consequence is that you accumulate lots of knowledge about specific things, but you don't have a way of getting knowledge which actually communicates across all of those different disciplines. And that is actually a fundamental epistemic or epistemological like problem. It's a problem to do. It's to do with the way we have developed our sciences, and what it's done is it's created this very serious problem that we are underestimating a lot of the major crises that we're now facing. And this is every single year. You know, the IPCC, for example, you know, the UN Climate Panel puts out their reports, and every single year they underestimate the scale of the problem. And I've been doing this talk. Just came back from Copenhagen, an academic thing, and I was asked to talk about climate change, blah, blah, blah. So literally all I did was just put these graphs up of comparing, you know, scientific predictions of things like sea level rise, the levels of heat accumulation on the planet, as well as the levels of greenhouse gas emissions and how fast they've risen. And all of these different things, you know, Arctic summer sea ice and the speed at which the Arctic has been melting, and every single element of the climate crisis, we've seen that things are off the scale, and the models are just consistently underestimating and out of touch with what's happening. And that's partly because, you know, the Earth system is actually just far more complex than what we are able to understand, and we're always playing catch up. Effectively, we're trying to understand the way these ecosystems work, the way they interconnect. Just to give a simple example, I mean, you guys are all familiar with the big thing about the global warming pause. Supposedly global warming stopped, you know, and it's all fine and we don't have to worry. But actually, what's really interesting is that, yeah, of course, climate scientists are all aware that global warming from a certain period of around, over the last couple of years, it has, the rate at which it's accelerated appears to have slightly decreased a little bit. So it's not that the temperatures have gone down, but the rate of increase has kind of slowed down. But this was kind of anticipated by the models. But what wasn't anticipated was the extent to which heat has been accumulating in the oceans. 90% of heat from global warming is being absorbed into the oceans. And at some point, the oceans aren't going to get saturated and all that heat's going to come out. We don't actually know when that is going to happen. We don't really know much about what the triggers for that might be. So we're kind of riding blind. So that's just to give an indication that even when it comes to the cutting edge science, you know, and we're measuring, you know, surface to air temperatures, blah, 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 suddenly it's like in the last few years, the deniers have been banging on and scientists have been looking at this and like, oh shit, you know, we've got like 90% of the heat in the oceans and it's ready to come out at some point. So there's a lot of this stuff going on. But I think in terms of like, so that's the kind of the main point I want to make, that it's really important in terms of our, the way we look at the problem, we recognize the interconnections. And I think in terms of like addressing some of the stuff that has come up in the previous sessions, in terms of the way in which our societies are responding, the way in which we are seeing this trajectory towards the surveillance society, the corporate dominated society, the kind of erosion of democracy. All of that, in my view, is very much symptomatic of the current way in which we look at things. It's a very narrow way of thinking, very narrow of looking at things. And what we have at the moment is this problem where you've got the people who run the show, effectively, and I'm using that in a very loose term. I'm not using it in a kind of very fixed conspiratorial term because it's not as simple as that. But the people who essentially run the show, whether you know banks, corporations, governments, financial networks, all these kind of institutional revolving doors and interlinkages, they basically think that the way they do things is the best possible way. I'm sure there's a Machiavellian element here, but there's also an ideological element here, which is simply, this is just the best possible way. There isn't an alternative. You know, why should we do anything else? And this is the impression I got when I was going through some of the planning documents coming out of national security, various national security agencies in the UK and the US, planning for the impact of things like climate change, energy, and the economy. And it's interesting, actually, that the agencies that are planning for these things are not, say, like the Department of Health or something. It's the military that is being asked to look, and well, let's get the military to kind of plan. And the problem is that when you ask the military to plan for something, and what's really interesting is that, you know, I've spoken to some of these military guys, and they're kind of like, you know what, we've actually got a real problem, and we're worried about the fact that, you know, we're going to have a liquid fuels crisis, you know, by 2018, because shale gas isn't going to cut it. You know, we know this. And these guys are very pragmatic, and they're actually want to see, and these are military guys who want to see change, but they're being asked to come up with solutions. So the solutions these guys come up with, if you're going to ask a guy with a gun to solve, like, you know, Arctic is melting, he's going to be like, okay, so, you know, I could shoot this. I need to shoot something. What do I shoot? And then, you know, suddenly it's like, emergency, you know, Bin Laden has come and the Arctic's melting. God knows, you know, the drones start coming out. You know, let's just blow the Arctic up. That will solve everything. You know, that's the kind of reaction that you've got. And so literally, you know, you're looking at what the military is planning and it's just like, okay, so this is the problem. We have this existing system. Our problem is to defend security. So we have to defend Britain, US, Europe. We have to defend our chains of supply. We have to defend our access to resources. We have to defend the way things are going. And this is just the way it is. We just have to do this. And so literally, you end up going down this trajectory of, if that's what we defend, then the threat is lots and lots of population growth in places like the Middle East and North Africa, where there's going to be what they call youth bulges. And most of those places are actually Muslim majority regions. And whoa, wait a minute, they actually happen to be areas where we have a strategic interest in fossil fuels, which we need to basically maintain some kind of access to keep our economies going, which is good for everybody, right? So, okay, we need to now invest resources in expanding our ability to go into places like the Middle East and North Africa to police them and be prepared for all manner of contingencies. So that's the slippery slope that we're on at the moment. And that then leads to the other problem, which is then when you're trying to anticipate where the threats are going to come from, where the insurgencies are going to come from. And I mentioned the Pentagon's Minerva initiative in the last session, in the Q&A. And I want to come back to that because for me, this really highlights the kind of the crossroads that we're at. And the Pentagon's Minerva Initiative was set up in 2008, coincidentally, when the financial crisis hit. And it's basically like this social science research program. It's not the only time that the Pentagon has been trying to co-opt social scientists for many years, if not decades, especially anthropologists. But what they've been doing with this multi-billion dollar program, I think it's multi-million actually. There's something like $80 million, I think, every year, which fluctuates. And what they're doing is they're trying to get social scientists to help them develop new tools, methodologies to be able to predict insurgencies, to track social movements, to understand where the next threat is to US interests. And what's really dangerous about this? So, I mean, I broke a couple of stories. One, the first time I broke it was in The Guardian, which I looked into the whole Minerva thing. And the second round of stuff I did, I couldn't do through The Guardian for editorial reasons, which, you can guess what I mean. And I did it via Occupy.com, and it's a four-part series. It's very in-depth, and you can just Google Occupy.com Nafeez, and you'll be able to find it. But the stuff that came out from this investigation was that, apart from all of the general social science tools and kind of these very intrusive methodologies and the concepts of political radicalism, which basically equates nonviolent activists literally with supporters of political violence. So literally, there is not a recognition, there's not a definition being used by the Pentagon of political radicalism, which is nonviolent per se. They actually say nonviolent activists are supporters of political violence. And it's like, I've spoken to academics involved in the program who are like, these definitions are ridiculous. But they're just there, sitting there. And when I asked the Pentagon people about it, they just didn't really answer the questions. But where it gets really dangerous is where they're trying to bring all of this into the domain of the NSA and the CIA and surveillance. And now what they're doing is through Arizona State University, from 2008 to 2014, they had a program with Arizona State University called Understanding Radicalization and Counter-Radicalization Muslim Discourses. And it was headed up by a Stanford anthropologist who had, his name escapes me now, but he's actually got an interesting track record. He's actually worked as a CIA consultant. In the past, he sat on a board that was set up by the CIA to track state failure in the 1980s during the Cold War. So this whole program at Arizona State University, when I started looking into it, was basically a data mining program. It was basically trying to create algorithms and visual data analysis tools that would allow whoever was using them to basically download huge amounts of information which is on the web, and including websites, tweets, Facebook, you name it, any form of social media, and subject it to automatic analysis that would be able to categorize threats. Now, when I got access to one of the online tools that are being used to actually scale and assess so-called organizations which are threats, I discovered that there was one. There was a list, for example, of British Muslim NGOs that were actually not all British Muslims. We had Stop the War Coalition. We had the Center for Nuclear Disarmament. We had various environmental groups. So this was very clearly not actually about Muslim radicalization, counter-radicalization discourse. This was about tracking dissent. And when I spoke to Thomas Drake, the NSA whistleblower, who the same very really well known in the community, in whistleblower community, in the tech community, also was the inspiration for Edward Snowden. And I asked him about these algorithms and what their use could be. And I said to him, my hunch is that these could actually be used to end up, even classifying who should be put on the drone kill list. That's kind of the level that we're looking at. And he said to me, Nafeez, you're actually right. Your hunch is absolutely spot on. These are the same kind of algorithms that he has seen being used by the CIA to basically determine who they should think is a threat that could end up on a drone kill list. So that's the level that we're looking at. And when I went back to the Pentagon and I was like, you're supposed to be funding basic research, which is like, you say, long-range, academic, scholarly research, which doesn't really have direct implications for operations. But what's happening here is that you've got stuff which is directly applicable to operations. And in fact, there was an internal email that was sent by one of the staff members of this program, basically talking about how Pentagon officials were pressuring them to produce tools that could be taken directly to the field. So this was basically about producing tools, harnessing the so-called expertise of the social science community, the anthropological community, regional area experts who could basically input their expertise into making these algorithms so, you know, supposedly accurate. So, you know, one of my friends' name came up as a reviewer for the tools of how these organizations were being scaled. And I, you know, obviously when his name came up, I was like, what the hell are you doing on this thing? And I spoke to him and I said, you know, what was this about? And he said, well, a colleague asked him, you know, to go into this tool and just scale the organizations. And he said it was just a bit of a social science exercise. And he said, but, you know, I looked at it and I thought the scaling methodology was ridiculous and it was very, very weak. And I gave my feedback. And I said, did you know this was funded by the Pentagon? He said, Pentagon? What are you talking about? And he basically shat himself because he's a Muslim and he's an expert in Islamic studies. He's well known in the community as a progressive kind of activist. So he was really worried about this association. So that's what's happening. You're seeing this attempt to basically take expertise, fine-tune the ability to analyze social media, combine it with the analysis of metadata to create this, you know, predictive behavioral analytics effectively, to pinpoint the next threat. And that's kind of what we're up against. That is the trajectory that we're on at the moment. So in terms of like how we link all of that up, in my view, the problem is that this is what happens when you have an ideology which is very fragmented, reductionist, and doesn't understand the root causes of where we're at. And so what I see our mission being as citizens is being able to, number one, basically create a more holistic and systemic understanding of what's happening in the world, how these crises interconnect, and then move towards creating meaningful visions for people to actually engage with now, here and now, that can begin to undercut these processes. Because these people are going to keep doing this crazy shit that they're doing. But it's very important. And, you know, to what extent we can counter that, I don't know. But I think we need to basically start thinking about how we can create new forms of social, political, and economic reality here and now that can make those kinds of activities, in a way, obsolete. That's kind of what I think is our vision and our mission.
Thank you, Nafeez. Amy, what do you think? You've been reporting on a lot of the issues Nafeez talked about for such a long time. War and repression, climate change, all these things. Mm-hmm. How do you feel about the current state of the world and of the planet?
Mm. Well, you know, as a journalist, we have a couple of jobs to do in independent media. One is to be there on the ground, telling the story from the grassroots, from the people closest to the story, whatever the particular issue is. But the other, we have to deconstruct the story that's been told in the rest of the media. Because how does someone get from where they've been told about something to what's actually happening on the ground? You have to acknowledge they may understand things in a very different way that may not come from their direct experience, but just how the corporate media frames it. And I can't think of a better example of a movement that connects everything and looking at how to cover it than Occupy, right? The movement that covered all these different issues. In the United States, the media, the corporate media, would often mock the Occupy movement. Remember September 17, 2011, thousands of people march on Zuccotti Park and it launches many different encampments all over the country and around the world, although things had happened before that inspired it and continue to happen. I remember a big CNN show happening to begin that week, and the day before, the host, Erin Burnett, was talking about how her show would be very different from everyone else because she was going to be talking to everyday people, and she was going to really get an impression of what was going on and convey that from the people who were most affected. Most of the corporate media did not touch Occupy for at least a week, even though we were broadcasting that, you know, New York is the media metropolis of the world. They were walking by the Occupy encampment, but they just weren't covering it. And then her show the next week, her first show that she started with, the person who is going to go talk to people on the ground, her segment on Occupy was called Seriously. And they would mock them by saying, well, these people do not know what they want. I mean, they're talking about every single different issue. Now, that was true. That was an honest representation of what was happening. Yes, people were deeply concerned. It's what drew so many different people. And, you know, the signs that said, hell, snow, we won't go, which was about climate change, to the signs as people marched on September 17th into Zuccotti Park that said, I am Troy Davis, about the death penalty, a man who was destined to die or scheduled to die a few days later on September 21st on death row in Georgia. So what do these issues, how are they connected? Then you had Scott Olson, a young man who served in Iraq for two tours of duty, who comes back to the United States and said, what exactly did I do this for? He came from a military family in Wisconsin. Many of his relatives had served in the military. And so when he came back, he saw what spoke to him most, and that was Occupy Oakland in California. So he was standing there in his fatigues. He was also deeply concerned that they were being threatened. He thought, wait, I thought I fought there for freedom of speech, for basic American values, and how are people being shut down in the United States? And he's hit with a police projectile in the head. He was gravely wounded, and he was taken to the hospital. He ultimately didn't get VA care. He almost died, Veterans Administration care for a veteran, because they had once accused him of using drugs in the military, something he absolutely denied, but he had no means of appeal, so he wasn't even getting the care that a soldier should get. Or a veteran should get. He ultimately would win a multi-million dollar lawsuit against the police of Oakland for what they did to him. But talking about the issues of the war at home and the lack of funding at home and connecting that with the war abroad, that sign, those signs that said, I am Troy Davis, so important, linking violence abroad with violence at home. And so we flew from Occupy Wall Street in New York, where we're based. How many of you watch or listen to or read Democracy Now! At any point? Well, I hope all the rest of you do. I always see it as an opportunity if more than half the people don't raise their hand. It's a great reason to be here, and I hope you get those flyers. It shows where we are. But just check out democracynow.org. But we cover these kind of critical issues every single day. It's a daily grassroots global broadcast. Since we were invited here to Elevate yesterday, we broadcast. And a big shout out to Octo and those who are watching on Octo, because we're so honored that Democracy Now! Airs on Octo every day. So we broadcast from Octo yesterday in Vienna, and we looked at issues of nuclear power, nuclear weapons. We looked at issues of the Iran negotiations that are going on in Vienna now. And our last segment was talking about what Snowden revealed and what it means for privacy, how people are protecting their privacy in Europe. But so we flew down to Georgia, connecting these issues. And I thought it also was a microcosm about how the independent media works and the corporate media. The death penalty is foreign to you Europeans. It is the state of being in the United States, or non-being, if you're a person on death row, what happens to you. Most people in the United States don't know how alone the United States is in executing people, that the death penalty is so unusual in the industrialized world. So Troy Davis was an African-American, one of 3,200 men and women on death row in the United States. He constantly said that he was innocent of killing the person they said he had killed. The Pope weighed in. The former head of the death row prison weighed in. They all said, the Republican congressman from Georgia, Bob Barr, weighed in. They all said, this guy should not be being executed. And yet he was. Three death warrants had passed and had been canceled because he had such a controversial, questionable case. This was the fourth. We didn't know it would happen. But we knew that as journalists, it's our job to be there. If we could be in the death chamber filming, we would. because it's our job to go to where the silence is and say something. And so we got to the grounds of the prison, the Jackson prison, where 100 men were held. And we hired the truck that CNN and Fox hire, you know, just a broadcast truck, because we thought if we're going to cover this issue, we have to have the big boys behind us. So all the other broadcast trucks were lined up in down the road. So when we came over, the guards said, you have to go over there. I thought, how can we cover? Who knows how long this will go on tonight? I don't know if Troy Davis will be killed or whether he'll live, but there was a massive protest pen set up. Over, they allow in 150 people there. 1,000 people were holding candles outside. Many black students from the historically black colleges in Atlanta, Spelman and Morehouse. Morehouse is where Dr. King, Martin Luther King, graduated from. But if we were going to broadcast for hours, I wasn't going to speak myself for hours. We had to be near where the people were. So why weren't all these elite journalists also protesting and saying, we can't be over in the corner? Well, why bother? They're going to be on for 20 seconds, if that. They're going to say if Troy Davis dies. They don't need many people to talk to. But we're there to bear witness. And so our truck was late. It came up on the grounds. It drives up, and they say to me, where do you want to go? And I see the guards are coming. Or I said, well, the guards are saying, they said, no. This is your truck. Where do you want to be? I said, well, right over there, right over where the protest pen is. And so they barrel over to this truck. And these guys who hold the cameras, they're twice as big as the guards. They get out, and the guards are backing off. And they hand me the microphone, and they said, where do you want to stand? So I said, well, I guess against that rope over there. And they said, start broadcasting. And so we did. It was 6 o'clock. In Georgia, they execute prisoners 7 o'clock Georgia time. So we began the broadcast. It was so highly emotional. The family was in the middle of this protest pen. The heads of Amnesty International and the NAACP, they were all there. People had come from around the world. They described to us what happened that day. From 9 to 3 in the afternoon, family and friends could say their goodbyes to Troy if, in fact, he would die. But at 3, they had to clear out, because that's when they do the medical exam, the regular medical exam on the patient, on Troy Davis. See, they had to make sure he was physically fit enough to be executed. In Texas recently, a man had tried to commit suicide when he was about to be executed, and they raced him to the hospital, got him better, and then they executed him. So they had done the regular medical exam, and we were now waiting what would happen. Didn't know if the death warrant would be vacated or not. The Supreme Court justice in charge of this particular case was Clarence Thomas. He hailed from Pinpoint, Georgia, a community of freed slaves not far from Savannah, where Troy had grown up. At 10:57, we got the word that Troy Anthony Davis, the execution, had begun. And at something like 11:09, they announced he was dead. The witnesses came out. The way it works, it's a ritual in the United States. You are brought out, the prisoner, on a gurney and a cross-like gurney, and you're strapped down to it. You get last words to say to the audience before you. They pull the curtains back on glass, and there are the family members of the victim, the people you invite if you're allowed to have them in, the authorities decide, it was his lawyers, and then the reporters who will report the scene with pens and pencils. And the reporters came out to convey Troy Davis's last words. They said he looked up, he looked at the family of the victim, and he said, I feel for your loss, for your father, for your brother, but I am not the one who killed him. I did not have a gun, and I really encourage you to dig deeply into this case to find out who did. He turned to his lawyers. He said, please tell my family and supporters to continue to fight not only this case, but against the death penalty And then he turned to his executioners. You know, these prison guards often suffer terrible PTSD. This is their job. They have to do this. Post-traumatic stress disorder. And he turned to his executioners. He said, God have mercy on your souls. God bless your souls. And they killed him. The body was brought to Atlanta, an hour away, for an autopsy. The family was charged for the transportation. Just to end this, it was around a quarter to midnight. We just continued to broadcast in the mud outside. The prison guards came and surrounded our set, and they said, this has to end now, or we're pulling the plug. You know, the show was over. And I could only think, as I looked out that night on this crowd of people deeply mourning what has taken place, not only for one man, but for our country, I could only think of what Gandhi had said when asked what he thought of Western civilization. He answered, I think it would be a good idea. So these issues, they are all connected. And I think it's very important to show that it's not the weakness of movements to show these connections. Of course, Tri-Anthony Davis was African American. We see what's happening in Ferguson today, and that is not atypical in the response to the protests of white police officer killing yet another young unarmed black man is tanks in the street that come from Afghanistan and Iraq because the Pentagon is being conservationist. They don't wanna just pulp these tanks. So why not, when you bring them back to our country, put them in the cities and the towns, along with drones, to reuse them, recycle them. But of course, what comes with the military equipment is the military stance, the attitude, and those that use them are like occupying forces. So showing all these connections, I think, is not only the strengths of the movements, the power of movements that bring in so many, but it is the strength of independent media that is there on the ground reflecting all that is happening there, giving voice to people who are not usually heard, yet actually represent the majority of people. I mean, that is so important. When the media mocks Occupy today and says, so where is it? You know, what happened? I mean, that was a joke. Really, that was a complete failure. What other movement changed the language entirely? You say the word 99% now, everyone knows what you're talking about. You say 1%, not only the 1% know. Everybody knows what you're talking about. They occupied the language. And that has changed everything and shown all the connections between it. And I think it very much shows, you know, my colleague Dennis Moynihan and I wrote this book called The Silenced Majority. And the reason we call it that is because those who are concerned about war and peace, those who are concerned about racial, social, economic injustice, those who are concerned about climate change, about the fate of the planet, are not a fringe minority, not even a silent majority, but the silenced majority, silenced by the corporate media, which is why we have to take it back.
Thank you, Amy. Friederike, as an historian, as a political scientist, as an economist, how do you view the world at the moment, the status the planet and our societies are in?
Yeah, Amy quoted just Gandhi saying the Western civilization would be a good idea. I think the stage we are at is really a multiple crisis, something Nafeez makes very clear, and many other people as well. And I found it interesting that the movie and also your book, The Crisis of Civilization, this comes from is an indigenous term because so often the civilization is mistaken as the Western civilization, and then Western civilization is mistaken as capitalism, even among really very progressive left-wing people with whom I fully agree in what they want for the future and everything. Then suddenly it comes to a point saying, yes, but we have to defend the Western civilization, really forgetting about this whole history of colonialism. And then I have the impression that capitalism becomes like something of a Rambo, saying, and we say, oh, this hero or this guy, he shouldn't be as brutal and less masculinist, but we still need him to save the world. And I think this is a really fundamental misunderstanding. And also, when we speak about the multiple crises and we see all these ecological aspects and the starvation crisis and all these different crises, I wouldn't say you can reduce it to. It misleads you also if you say you can reduce it to economy, but it is rooted absolutely in the economy and in capitalism. And we spoke about this yesterday already in the moment. It could be a very interesting moment with even newspapers like the Handelsblatt, the financial newspaper in Germany, speaking of red alert. This could be crisis 2.0 because all the means governments have to try to make the economies grow having been used for so many years now since the start of the first crisis, and it doesn't help anymore. And so this could be a very precise point we are in the moment at. but maybe speaking about capitalism, I think we must understand both. We must understand that it's our way of life on the one side, that it's got to do with our personal behavior in it, but that we're also seduced sometimes forced to behave in a certain way because of the structures that are there. And this is the double bind we have to deal with and which makes it so difficult to get out from here. And maybe speaking now for more from the activist side, Amy, you referred to Occupy as well, saying that they were accused of talking about every single issue. And I think what expresses itself in this is that people really understand that absolutely the whole concept of life we're supposed to live is at stage, that we need to change it, because it's not only the currency, and it's not only financial markets, and it's not only climate, but it's really everything. And people feel it closely in their personal lives when they become ill or whatever, when they become stressed. And Occupy for me is a way to say, okay, we recreate our world, we recreate our daily life and the space we're living in. We recreate how we organize our economy on these places. And on the other side, what maybe had been lost in comparison to the alter globalization movement, where I was strongly involved 10, 20 years ago, starting from that point maybe, is that we had been much more connected globally, I would say. This had not been very well known worldwide, but there had been networks that were really among grassroots movements from the global south, also with movements in the global north. And this way, avoiding that we can think here of, okay, there's the climate change, so we make emission rights, and but this then in the global south misleads really to forests being cut in the name of emission rights, for example. And we must not stuck with among ourselves to find solutions. We really need to reconnect globally and to connect globally as deeply as we never did before to be able to find democratic solutions for all the crises we're facing at. Yeah, so.
Felix, what do you think? Would you agree that we're not so, that we could be connected better?
I guess. I think the question you're asking is kind of impossibly difficult to address because there's so many different kind of levels at stake. I think on the most basic level, we're seeing a very fundamental transformation of social institutions. And for a long time, we've seen this as the erosion of kind of existing institutions, the hollowing out of representative democracies, the hollowing out of kind of the traditional institutions of civil society, churches and unions and others. But over the last maybe 10, 15 years or so, we're really seeing the emergence of new institutions. So this transformation, basically that started probably in the late 60s, is now really in a formative phase where we see kind of new, very powerful social institutions emerging. And they're extremely contradictory. So they're basically two kind of trajectories that take place at the same time. One is kind of what Nafeez has been describing, kind of this direction of very centralized kind of repressive institutions that take over functions that used to be served by kind of more civil aspects of the government. So there's a wholesale transformation from legislative power to executive power, and the military and security apparatuses are growing everywhere, not just in the US, that's maybe the most extreme, but also here. And you see more and more aspects of that used to be within our reach of democratic deliberation disappearing. We cannot talk about this anymore. We don't know about this anymore. We're not supposed to talk about to know about this anymore. We should simply trust that it's for our good. So there's a wholesale kind of reemergence of a very authoritarian, repressive set of institutions. At the other side, we also see a very deep disaffection with that, and an incredible explosion of social experimentation on all levels. We see it even in countries that are relatively wealthy and not particularly socially active, like in Austria. You see any kinds of experiments with food co-ops, with alternative currencies, with new ways of organizing renewable energies and all of that. So you have two very contradictory developments going on at the same time. They're all based on the same technological infrastructure, the internet. We need it. It's both kind of the basis of repressive organizations. You mentioned kind of all the data gathering of that, but it's also what you need to run a food co-op that you can, you know, schedule and that you can collaboratively, you know, manage inventory and all of that. So this is the same technological basis that is now fueling two very different and contradictory social projects. At the moment, I think kind of quantitatively and qualitatively, the repressive forces and the buildup of repressive institutions is much stronger. But the sheer scale of experimentation sometimes because people are driven to it because they have no other chance of survival, sometimes because it's because of a deep disaffection with how things are being run, offers a lot of potential to do that, to really think about social institutions that integrate the economic and the social and the environmental in very complex ways, that you can talk about everything at the same time, but still remain keep a focus. Because I think on the one hand, yes, something like Occupy was really interesting in terms of how he connected things, but it's very hard to trace so many connections at the same time without losing focus. But once you start building another set of institutions, something simple as a food co-op, you suddenly are capable of talking about everything. You talk about how the food comes, you talk about how labor is distributed, you talk about kind of economic aspects, you talk about ecological sustainability, but still in a very focused way that you can actually, you know, get something done. So the difficulty is now how do you relate these two developments? Because you mentioned that too, this security apparatus buildup is not just for external terrorists. I mean, we see what a crummy job they do on that front, right? So this is clearly not working. And this clearly cannot be their justification. So this is really also for internal security. And this will make any effort to scale these small-scale, innovative projects beyond what you could call a systemic threshold extremely difficult.
Thank you, Felix. Up next is Silke. And Silke, as I said before, is a commons activist, and I'm sure that Silke has always still this view and sees the commons everywhere in a lot of the statements. And also it fits very well to what Felix said in the end, and it's always such an interesting and decisive question. How are these small projects, I don't think we can scale them up, but how is the small alternatives linked to bigger system changes and stuff? All this is discussed very vividly in the commons discourse. So maybe please make a statement from that perspective and also explain again what commons means and the practice of commoning.
I just was loving because I actually see the commons everywhere. But when I listened to you, Nafeez, and to you, Amy, I was thinking about how I would connect what I want to say with your stories. And I decided to ask two questions to the public. The first one is, did you feel empowered or frustrated when you listened to Nafeez? Empowered or frustrated? Empowered. Oh, I don't see many empowered people. So precisely, So precisely, I think we need power to transform the world for the better. And the second question is, have you been, when you were listening to the story of Joy Davis, have you been Joy Davis or not? Did you feel, I put it the other way around, did you feel connected to him? Hands up or not? So if you felt connected, it's basically saying something that the commons is there, it is in you. It is based on the very principle of Ubuntu that my well-being depends on the well-being of other people, which is a social relationship, which is that the commons, in fact, is about unfolding our humanity as a paradigm shift. So I slightly disagree with what Felix just said. That's about the danger of losing focus. I'm not worried about the danger of losing focus. I'm worried about staying in the same paradigm, So we cannot lose focus if we focus on switching the paradigm. And that is why I constantly work upon the commons. First of all, because it empowers me. I see so many innovation out there, you just said it. I mean, I constantly meet people who do amazing stuff with nothing, with no money, no investment, no state, no government. It's beyond market and state. And this empowers me, and it's young people. And the second thing that empowers me is that the commons, if you think about it as a worldview, really enables you to kind of visualize one of the crises that has not yet been mentioned here, which is the crisis in the way we are taught to think, the crisis in the way our ideas are shaped, or to put it bluntly, the crisis of commodification of ideas. So the commons gives us a language to recommodify our ideas. That is, reconnect our ideas and the way we describe the world, that is, the way we describe economy, the way we describe politics, the way we talk in the media. I mean, switch on the media, it's commodified talk. It's awful. Everything is marketized. What do you learn at school? You learn that you need to go for a job and be better than other people, and being better than other people usually means that if you get a job, the other person doesn't. So nobody tells you how to think about this problem of structural exclusion. The commons is about structural inclusion. It is not with the people, as if a state would act with people, which is usually called participation. It is not for the people, as if private entities or the state would act for the people, kind of this social welfare state thing, which is great. I don't want to dismiss it, but we need to be aware of the fact that I've been living in four different countries. The social state thing has been a very wonderful but very real in world dimensions and international dimensions, very regional and historically short period. It is through the people. It's not with the people. It's not for the people. It's through the people. So these are some kind of the reasons why I like the commons paradigm without saying a word about what I understand by commons. So if I have a few more minutes to explain that. Well, first of all, the commons is not a thing. It is not linking it to what you told us about the atmosphere, right? And the climate change thing. Usually people say the atmosphere is a commons. It is not, and that is precisely the problem. The atmosphere is a resource, is something we share. It has to be converted into a commons. We need to take care of it. We didn't figure out the governance body or the governance, the way of governing collectively a shared resource. That is what a commons is about. In its most simple definition, it's collective stewardship and responsibility for a shared resource. That is, for all those things who don't belong to only one person. And this obliges us to define all those things which don't belong to only one person. Do ideas belong to only one person, just to mention it? There are wars about that question. So, if the commons is not a thing, what is it then? The commons is not a thing, and the commons is not a state. It doesn't fall from the sky. It is not given to us. We need to make it and constantly remake it. That is, the commons is a process. It is a social process, and therefore better described with a verb than with a noun, which is commoning. Or yesterday, there are some people who prefer other words like communalizing, as John Holloway yesterday spoke to us. So it is something, I would say, to put it in Amy's example, it's like, how did democracy now came into life? Not by the state, not by a producer, through a process of commoning. Mm-hmm. And this is what made democracy now. big because it was backed by the people and stewarded by the people. It was through cooperation, through the people themselves. So it's not a state, not a thing, but a process, which is called commoning. Oh, my notes. Where are my notes? I'm about to finish. Don't worry.
We're not worried.
And this process of commoning is precisely based on what the software or the people or the geeks in here certainly know as the Ubuntu principle. I am through you. My personal unfolding depends on the unfolding of others. And that is the very principle. That is what I mean by paradigm shift. The principle we need to build into the way we produce stuff, because it's not only about the social process and sharing and doing stuff and co-housing and co-using, etc. It's about producing that way. That is producing stuff, material, stuff, machinery, whatever. I mean, we can, through commoning today, produce cars. Here is one of the experts. It's called commons-based peer-to-peer production. I prefer to talk about the commons creating peer-to-peer production. We need to create not commodities, but the commons. And Michel Bowens is here with us, and he can tell you lots and lots of examples from all over the world. They do tractors and machinery and cars and whatever we think we need in the modern world through a different production process. Not the top-down thing, but peer-to-peer. And finally, commons for me is a worldview which precisely allows you, once it's like a lens, you know, you put it on and you see the world differently. And suddenly you realize that what the other guys who got stuck in the old paradigm with the categories which describe the world as a separated thing, as a kind of either-or world, the state or the market, the public or the private, the nature or the culture, the good or the bad, the object or the subject, the objectivity or the subjectivity. There is no such thing as an objectivity without subjectivity. Well, anyway, if you put this lens on, what you see is that there is no Tina, there is no alternative. You see tapas, there are plenty of alternatives. So the commons makes the tapas visible, and that is why I like it.
I'm getting hungry for commons. Really, not joking. But I know there's so many of you participating already in some cool initiatives and projects, so I'm pretty hopefully hungry. And please react. I mean, you are all free to.
Yeah, because I absolutely share Silke's fear that we will not overcome this paradigm we're living in, the rationality, the logic we're living in. I think this is the problem with all the solutions you generally find that normally they're market-based, and then they just recreate the same logic and the same problems in it. And Nafeez as well, I mean, you illustrated lively how experts just stuck to their own logic and how difficult it is for them, of course, but also for us to overcome it. And I think this also, we need to analyze capitalism, and it's not too difficult. And that makes it, for me, what makes commons so valuable, because I think there are kinds like local currencies and other alternative ways of doing economics that stuck very closely to the capitalist rationality. And I think commons are a way to really overcome it. And also what you quoted with Ubuntu, this also in feminism very a lot discussed, the understanding that, how the black communities in Colombia put it, I am because you are, we are because you are. So we are not individuals just summing up, adding up to a society, but the way we think, the way we are, the way we act is a result of how the logic of society works. And also that we live, when we are born, then people take care for us. So first, it's not the autonomous individual, but it's somebody, it's a living being that is being taken care for. So this is the original experience we all go through, and then we learn we have to be selfish and be competitive, etc. And yeah, but to overcome this logic is nothing you can sit at the desk and try to find the best solutions. This can only be created by the people when they start to make different experiences, alternative experience, like in Occupy or in alternative projects or in daily life, just when they become a bit more conscious, or sometimes not conscious, but feeling the Unbehagen, the discomfort with their life, and then try to look for other solutions, and then something new can begin.
I would like to, if I could just mention, Silke, you said, how did Democracy Now get started? And I think that gives me hope for so many other movements. We came out of an earlier movement called Pacifica Radio, and I don't know how many of you know that in the United States, what Pacifica is, but it's the only completely independent, non-corporate media network in radio. And it started after World War II. A war resistor in Berkeley, California named Lou Hill said, when he came out of the detention camps, you know, we need a media outlet that's not run by corporations that profit from war, that's run by journalists and artists. And that's how Pacifica was born in Berkeley, California, the first station, KPFA, not run by corporations. That late dean of communications at University of Pennsylvania, George Gerbner, said, not run by corporations that have nothing to tell and everything to sell that are raising our children today. So KPFA in Berkeley, 4959 KPFK in Los Angeles, 1960 WBAI in New York, WPFW in Washington, 77, and 1970 KPFT went on the air in Houston, Texas, which is a big deal. It's the Petro Metro, and there is this independent station. So what happens to it? It's the only radio station in the United States that was blown up. It was blown up by the Ku Klux Klan. Within the first weeks of operation, they strapped dynamite to the base of the transmitter, and they blew it to smithereens. So they were proud of this fact. I can't remember if it was the Grand Dragon or the Exalted Cyclops. Those are their names, the leaders of the Ku Klux Klan. But he said it was his proudest act. And I think that's because he understood how dangerous Pacifica is, how dangerous independent media is. Dangerous because it allows people to speak for themselves. And when you hear a Palestinian child or an Israeli grandmother or an aunt in Afghanistan, an uncle in Iraq, describing their own experience, that challenges the stereotypes, it challenges the hate groups. It doesn't mean you have to agree with them. How often do we agree with our family members? But you begin to understand where someone is coming from. And that's the beginning of peace. I think the media can be the greatest force for peace on earth. Instead, it's wielded as a weapon of war. And that's why we have to challenge it. So in 1996, we began almost 19 years ago, Democracy Now!, a daily grassroots election show. And it was just going to be a project for 9 months until the election happened. And I was the least likely one to be the host of the show, an election show. I was in Haiti covering this underground house. People were dying when they would go to the polls to vote. They were gunned down. And yet most people in the United States didn't even vote. Why would I go cover this? But I really thought this was a chance to look state by state at what people were doing. Because while others said, oh, they're just apathetic, I never thought people were apathetic. I just thought they were engaged in other ways. What were those ways? Why was it they thought they didn't have a choice in the electoral world, but they were deeply involved? So I thought this would be a way to cover that. The election happened. The show was supposed to be over, but there was such a demand for a show that brought out voices from the grassroots. We started on 8 community radio stations. And the way it would grow, you know, people hire PR people to reach out to stations, but that wasn't the model of Democracy Now! If you want a public radio or television show in your community, ask for it. We can't say to the station, you should take us. It has to come from a groundswell within the community wanting something that expressed some kind of reality about their own lives. And that's how this grew. And in September 11th, amazingly enough, 2001, that week of the terror attacks in the United States, we started on our first TV station by coincidence, but because we were the closest national broadcast to Ground Zero, we became emergency broadcast. And TV stations all over the country started to say, can we run the show? And when a TV station would run it, the radio station would say, can we run this show? So it was the first TV radio station, radio show in the country. And after 19 years now, on over 1,300 stations, many of those stations, the heads of those stations had said, never, never would we run a show like this. But because there was so much demand in one state, in Vermont, the public radio station said, absolutely not. And they were at a public meeting. Thousands of people put in a petition for it. And the commercial broadcaster, who is known for 3 things, he brought car racing to television. He runs the Red Sox. He said, you had a petition of thousands of people in the small state of Vermont to run what show? And so they said, well, we're not going to run it. It's Democracy Now! He said, I'll run it. Now, this was a guy came from a completely different world of sports and racing. And it's become the most popular show on his station. And that's reaching out to an entirely different group of people. But when you talk about the hope, there is a humanity in everyone. And if you can touch that, I think conservative and liberal lines are breaking down. People deeply care across the political spectrum about corporate control, the loss of control in their own lives. They care about issues of privacy. That's why, despite the fact that President Obama said, you know, with Edward Snowden, we would have had this conversation anyway, he said. Really? No. And it has touched people of every political stripe, wherever they live. They know that they're being watched, and that really touches a chord. When you can reach across and just speak both from your mind and your heart and let not us speak, but let people speak and describe their own stories, not the typical pundits you get on television. You know, you can almost name all of them in the United States. It doesn't matter their competing networks. They all go to the same people. These pundits who know so little about so much, explaining the world to us and getting it so wrong. You know, there's this enormous niche, which is the majority of the space where people live, the majority of people, and that doesn't resonate. And what everyone is doing here, trying to reach out in many different ways, I think the commons is something that everyone can relate to in one way or other. And that's where I think the hope is.
Well, I guess we already have a commons up here on stage. We're interacting a lot. Nafeez gives me a sign. But what I wanted to say is we'll make the commons bigger soon and also include all you guys to join the conversation. But first, one statement from Nafeez.
Well, yeah, I just wanted to follow on. I think this discussion really strikes at the core of what I said at the beginning. And actually, even the reaction, I think, that you gave from the audience strikes the same thing, which is how important it is to really frame our predicament in the right way. And that when you don't frame it in the right way and you don't have the right understanding or approach to it, you end up with frustration and negativity, and it can be very disillusioning and overwhelming. And in fact, and it is overwhelming. You know, you look at the crises that are going on and the way in which they're interacting, and they're so big and they're so global. And you kind of think, well, what can little old me do in response to this? And then you see the security state going crazy and it's this monolithic thing. So yeah, you know, you think it's frustrating, you know, you feel this sense of powerlessness. But when you actually frame it correctly, you realize that what is actually in crisis, and this is why I talk about this idea of the crisis of civilization, what is in crisis is something very specific. That what's in crisis is actually this, the negation of the commons. Capitalism, which actually just incidentally, she was a great lecturer at the Harvard Business School lecture. She was really great. I agreed with a lot of what she said. But what she said about capitalism was just, you know, she didn't understand capitalism. And I don't entirely blame her for that because she's rooted in business school economics. Was it Shoshana, her name was? Yeah, Shoshana. I mean, and that's not something I would kind of, I'm not surprised that she didn't understand capitalism, but capitalism is exactly that. Capitalism is, you know, you can talk about it as a relation of production or blah, 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 but it is a denial of the commons. It is the idea that actually there is the right of a number of good people can basically become owners of the means of production and exclude everybody else. And then you have to become, you know, a wage laborer and whatever. So this kind of binary thinking, which I think you really kind of nailed, this idea that there is this division, fragmentation, categorize everything, blah, 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 blah. That whole paradigm is actually dying. It's not that the world is dying, it's that paradigm which is dying. And this is when you realize that actually it's the system which is imploding on itself. And in fact, when you understand that actually we're in this phase now, since about 2005, we began to see in an escalating way the signs and the symptoms of it in these multiple crises. And now that's been reflected in terms of like what we're talking about in this commons, it's been reflected in the public discourse. I mean, if you look at all the opinion polls, fine, you know, people still are confused, they're not really sure what to make of it. But there's been this really interesting convergence of public opinion over the last decade. And now if you have conversations with people about the banks, it's like you were saying about Occupy and 99%. So much of what has happened in the last few years has actually become part of mainstream discourse. You know, people are skeptical of the banks. They're very skeptical of the representative democracy and the party political system. They know that there's too much money in politics. They're concerned about the environment. Even people who are climate deniers are still concerned about the environment. They don't like the idea of pollution. And actually, even despite all of the climate denial, there is a slim majority of people who basically believe and recognize that climate change is a problem. So you look at all of these different things, there has been this convergence of public opinion and there is this resurgence of awareness that there is something deeply, deeply wrong with our current trajectory. And that is the context in which when we then look at the response of the national security state, which is extend the repression and centralize power and all the rest of it, that is not a response from strength. That is a response from weakness. That is a response from losing control. And in fact, when you look at what the way in which the thinking is going on at that level, you can actually see that very, very clearly, Pentagon officials, Ministry of Defense officials in the UK, whatever, EU defense people, they are actually very, very scared of losing control. And that is why they're scared of what they call insurgencies and the threats out there and civil unrest and all of the different labels that they use to give what happens when people get angry and the system fails. And then they're out on the streets to say, this isn't going to work, people, you know, whether it's the Arab Spring or Occupy. And they want to label that as a security problem. That's all coming from the fact that they don't know what to do about that. And they know it's coming. They know the system is dying and they are preparing for it. So we're in this really interesting crossroads where if you project forward into the next 20, 30, 40 years, I can tell you it is absolutely inevitable that this system will not survive. It cannot survive. That is a scientific verdict. You look at what the climate scientists are saying. You look at what BP's own oil projections about oil and gas and the rest of it and take the most optimistic projections. By the end of this century, and that's being really optimistic about it, this particular way of doing things isn't going to survive. So there is this question mark over what is going to take its place. And I think what you were saying about the commons is, and what Amy was saying in this opportunity, you know, is this our moment.
What a
feel empowered by what you
said. Please, people in the audience and online, take this moment and use it as an opportunity to participate. If you participate online, please use the hashtag E14Connected so that we can connect with you.
Yeah, no? Does this work? Okay. I just, oftentimes, I feel really deeply with all of the things you said, and I think it means so much to get this out clear, because I'm so waiting for this. And I always think it's good to have some kind of word to be able to communicate what the idea is. And I think commons is a very great word for that. And I'd just like to throw in another word which might be an interesting thought. And it's it reaches out to the problem that we are so diverted and so differentiated now. And the main thing, I think, is we need to reconnect. We need to make everything about the relations we have. And therefore, in this world, I like to think this as us being part of an organism, of the organism which is our Earth. So just to throw in the word Earth organism could be a really nice theme to reconnect us.
Hearing military is preparing, my thought about what about the military? Can we make become the military become a commons?
Yeah, I just want to say that in the TV and all like that, there's just one thing to like save the world, and I think just a few people in the world just want to really are interested to like save it. And I think the first thing we should do is just like interest all the people to like do this, because it's like spare water and stuff like that. And just a few people just really are under this and wants to do this. And yeah.
My turn, yeah. I refer to Felix's talk about, you know, these emerging alternatives on the ground. What's your idea about scaling? Because I think this is a key issue. When I was young, I'm 56 now, you know, we were very concerned about Chile and Portugal, and we had this feeling that there was like a global movement for change. Nowadays, I feel that it's very much around localization and local initiatives. But I still feel that's not enough, that we need some kind of global scale to actually affect global structures. It's not enough just to do, you know, food production in your city, as it were, or even cooperative energy. So how do we go from the local to a kind of a scaling up where we can really affect global structures?
Like to throw in an example, because I think sometimes these new and old institutions are really messed up and the different kinds of participation are sometimes really difficult to separate. And the example is, Airbnb. Airbnb, it's couch surfing. It's a really nice thing. I've done it lots of times before the internet, during the internet, with friends, organized, not organized, same thing with organized hitchhiking, Mitfahrzentralen. Now there's Airbnb, and it is a platform, and it is really, really, really nice, but it's commodified. So maybe this example helps to talk a bit more about the different types of participation and institutions. Thank you.
Thank you. Maybe we should respond on the podium, Felix.
Yeah. To Michelle's remark, I'm always kind of conflicted about the commons beyond the state and the market. I mean, I understand where this is coming from, and I also understand that it's a different organizational logic. But I think given the role of the state, it is absolutely impossible to have commons scale beyond a certain niches without a deep transformation of the state, so that the state becomes commons enabling. I mean, there's usually also within this beyond market and state, we usually tend to think of the market, kind of the free market and all of that, and the state as separate entities, but they're actually the same.
But may I ask why you equal beyond with without?
Well, because I think the idea is that there are these two entities and we're going to create a third one. And I think the difficulty will be to wrestle and certain collective institutions, and at the heart, the state can be a collective institution. And I think we should not give up on certain ideas of the public. For example, I think it would be terrible to organize healthcare as a commons. And the reason for that is that most commons are producer institutions. So people producing something organize themselves in order to produce a use value rather than an exchange value. And they are usually organized for themselves first. I mean, we see that with free software. There's all these problems that it's done by developers for developers, so most other people cannot use it because they don't care about certain issues, because that's not their issues, and a lot of others. So. I think this is it's for me the scaling issue that Michel talked about is about how do we, on the one hand, develop new forms of commons. Absolutely, there are lots of areas where this is very powerful and has a lot of potential, but also redevelop the notion of the public as something that everyone, whether you belong to a particular community or not, whether this is your community garden or not, has a right in it, based on their human rights, general universal rights. And I think these two, when you think these two together, we might come to a point where we can actually scale that up beyond kind of communities helping themselves, which I think is a great idea. And I don't want to discourage that at all. But I think precisely on that scaling issue, we might run into an upper limit if we not think about how to reorganize and change basic kind of large-scale social structures that are deeply rooted in the state.
I think we need to differentiate what we are talking about. Of course, in the current situation, I would always say, yes, the state needs to step in healthcare, for example. But fundamentally, I mean, people who go to hospital these days experiences, and people working at hospitals experience it even more. All kind of work needs to be streamlined in capitalism, and all kind of care works is not really possible to streamline. It's not very profitable. So what happens on the one side? On the one side, as a patient, you are treated like a machine. There's no time that nurses can spend on you anymore. And second, these nurses are not Austrian or German or whatever people anymore. These people are normally have a migrant background, and this is because all kind of care work always had been excluded from the capitalist logic because you can't streamline it, and always outsourced it, pushed it towards people who were or are underprivileged, being slaves, housewives, or these days migrants. So this is the reality of the healthcare and capitalism. And of course, if we speak of commons on a as an utopian in a society, then this doesn't mean the six of us form a group, and if one of us falls ill, then we need to take care of you. Of course, this means to have a infrastructure, commons-based infrastructure, commons-creating infrastructure, that is not less institutionalized or sophisticated than capitalism, but it is not structural hate, as had been explained as well by Silke, but it is structural community, and this is what we need. And of course, with Airbnb as well, this is what I said in the beginning, we need to analyze what misleads what we are, our experiences, and what leads towards where we want to go. Airbnb is being misused with capitalist logic, and I would say everybody taking part in it, it's not evil, but well, there would be the opportunity to have an alternative web-based institution like Airbnb that does not work in this capitalist logic. And we need to differentiate this. When the the magazine Spiegel in Germany, spoke about the sharing economy, it mixed it completely up. Airbnb and Uber, all these capitalist examples of sharing economy with food sharing, for example, like the box in front of the entrance here. What's got it to do with capitalist profit? Nothing. So we need to become aware, and as it has been very important in the umsonst economy, as it's called in German, what would be in English? So this
gift economy.
Gift is private.
For free.
Gift is not the right thing, neither. But in certain current of people thinking in commony terms, that we need to keep out this kind of logic, and that we need to make sure that that what we create creates this different logic and not capitalist logic anymore. And then probably military, maybe to add this one as well. I think theoretically you can imagine a military being a commons as well. If people think they have to use, they need it, then it would be a commons. If they're created together, it would be a commons. But for me, a commons always needs to be open, because if it's just one commons by one group, and then you have the other group with another commons, then this is common property. This is not commons. Mm-hmm.
It's so good, as economists would say. Mm-hmm.
So it is the free access, open access, always difficult to explain. For everybody, and this makes it much more difficult for the military already.
I think probably there can not be ever a communist military, but maybe there can be communist militias. And maybe Nafeez wants to share a bit about that, because I'm sure he knows a lot about it, what's going on with the Kurds in Kobane, because maybe that's some sort of communist militias, what they're doing there, fighting back against the crazy guys of the Islamic State.
You want me to talk about what's going on in Cobane?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Or maybe slightly left field. Include it a bit into your next statement.
Well,
let me
contextualize it, and then I'll talk about it. I mean, like, I was just thinking, like, in terms of the stuff about, scaling up. And I think what Felix was saying was actually quite interesting, in the sense that there is this challenge, you know, when we're talking about these ideas and then you're looking at the context of the reality of the state and the market, it seems as if what we're talking about is a third entity. Mm-hmm. And it is, in a way, because the reality is that we're talking about entrenched institutions, and that's a reality we have to deal with. But I think it's important that, as this comes to something that Antonino was saying about not being ideological in the way that we approach these things. And I think when you turn commons into an ideology, like the state and the market, then it becomes a problem. Like, it can become, okay, this is the third institution that we need to create now. There's going to be now a conflict with the existing market and the state, which then blocks off the potential for transformation. Whereas I think what was interesting about what you were saying, Felix, was that there is this opportunity to be able to explore how we can actually transform the market and transform the state through the idea of the commons until what you've created then is not even necessarily what it was. It's not actually necessarily the state anymore. It might be something else. I mean, I don't know. But I think being open to that transformation and being kind of humble enough to know that actually, well, I don't know what it might look like, but I know that there is an ethos, which is not something that is, I can come up with a concept and a theory, but is about that relationship between people and the value system. I think that's the core. And I think that's, obviously that's kind of, I mean, it kind of probably doesn't address the issue of, the specific issue of how do you scale. But I think in a way we need to get away from these kind of like very big theoretical challenges that we pose to ourselves. Like, okay, so now I've come up with this amazing concept of a alternative currency and how do I scale this globally? You create this huge insurmountable obstacle which you then now have to climb, and I don't think we need to do that. I kind of feel like my feeling is like exact, and I kind of feel like the way in which a lot of the stuff we've all discussed, and it also comes back to another thing Anthony was saying about creative response. This idea that actually as individuals, you can respond creatively to a problem or a crisis or a negative thing in the context that you're in, and you don't necessarily know the outcome and don't even necessarily control the outcome. And in fact, you can be totally pragmatic about what you can control and can't control. There's no flipping way I'm going to be able to like stop the Pentagon and stop NSA. That's not my job. I can't do that. But I know what I can do based on who I am, the people I'm around, the people I'm friends with, the community I'm in. I've got skills. This is what I like to do. I can think about that, assess it, and say, oh, well, this is what I want to do. Let me do something. Let me create this. And I think that's what creative response is about, this idea that you're basically taking the best of yourself, applying it to the best of your context, and applying it with this ethos, you know, of the commons, and creating something new, which can then be transformative. And in my experience, when I've seen that done, when I've done it myself, I've seen stuff happen, which I'm just like, wow, I would not have expected this to happen. And I think like your story of the growth and evolution of democracy now, I mean, and where democracy now is in the present compared to then, I mean, that's like an amazing transformational story of how, I bet at that time when you were like, you know, starting up and struggling, having to deal with all this, you know, stuff, coverage and blah, 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 that you would not have imagined, like, you know, 19 years down the line, boom, this is democracy now. And I think that's the amazing thing, is that when you take that creative response, what comes out of it, you don't know, but it can be amazing. And I think that's really important to kind of recognize. On the issue of the Pentagon, and the military, I mean, my simple answer is no. You cannot make a commons out of the military by definition, unless you completely transform what you mean by the military. The military is basically a centralized structure. It is the monopoly of the means of violence, and it is institutionally connected to a state. So there's no way you can create a commons out of that.
Actually, are you saying you should make the Pentagon uncommon?
I think this is the thing. I mean, do we want to have a security system which is based on a pretty unaccountable centralized entity which kind of like willy-nilly goes to war and kind of sees threats everywhere, gets like, oh my God, let's bomb. And it's like creates problems down the line which then we have to bomb again. I mean, look at Iraq. We went there, bombed, occupied, you know, we kind of sorted it out, left, and now we're back. This is the ridiculous self-defeating logic of that centralized thing. So I would think that there needs to be, I'm not saying let's not have any kind of security or blah, 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 or don't even have intelligence agencies at all, but there must be ways to open up that accountability, apply that thing. But with these kind of structures, then you're completely transforming the ethos, because the ethos of the Pentagon is that unaccountability.
Yeah.
Decisions are made in a command and control structure, and you're not allowed to question that structure. You're a soldier, you get your orders, and you basically go down into Iraq and you say, I'm not going to shoot people in the street. And then, well, but what you've done is treason. You know, and you can actually be put on trial for not murdering someone because you're not following your orders. So there are real, I mean, I don't see how you can turn the military just like that into a commons, but I think it's an interesting discussion to have. And on that note, in terms of what's happening in Kobane, I mean, I'm not really sure what you want me to say about that, except to say, I think we need to be really skeptical of what's everything that is happening at the moment in that part of the world. I mean, what's happening in Kobane now? I mean, they could have, I mean, even if, let's look at it from the militarized logic of the Pentagon. if they wanted to actually deal with ISIS properly, they could have started with the funding, because all our friends are funding these, were funding these guys. I don't know what they're doing now. They could have started by talking to the countries that are opening pipeline, like, you know, like Turkey is sitting there. And when we go to Iran, we say, Iran, you're funding terrorists and you're doing this and we have to have sanctions on you. But our buddy Turkey in NATO has basically been allowing ISIS fighters through and actually preventing the Kurds from going and resisting. And we're kind of just sitting there saying, you know, Turks, you know, just get in the coalition, yeah, just get in the coalition quietly. We won't put sanctions. We won't condemn them publicly. We won't say, why are you sponsoring terrorists? So there is this real problematic thing, you know, in that sense.
But and there's Saudi Arabia.
And there's Saudi Arabia and the UAE and Kuwait, you know, and that whole network of Gulf states, which, you know, I mean, the reality is that ISIS is a creation of Joe, well, Joe Biden said it, right? Did you remember the press conference he gave? He gave this press conference 2 weeks ago, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and it was really funny the way the press covered it, because he basically came out and was just like, you know, basically our friends, Saudi Arabia, UAE, he just called it out. And he was like, these guys basically created ISIS. They've been funding, they were so eager to get rid of Assad that they poured loads of money. And they put this money largely went to al-Nusra and it went to, you know, basically the Islamist militants. This is something that people like me have basically been complaining about for years. That look, what the hell are we doing in Syria? You know, we're not even funding, like, and what we're doing is we're asking the most virulent nutcase regimes that have a history of dealing with these people, and we're saying, can you fund the secular rebels? And don't worry, and our vetting process, you know, we have these confidential CIA assessments which keep telling us, you know, every couple of months that all the weapons are actually going to the Islamists. And then at the end of it, we're like, how did that happen, man? What? Oh, man.
You, know, you mean just when, like, the US just dropped weapons to ISIS? Oh, and
that
one ISIS. As well.
I mean, that was even worse, you know. I mean, that was like, it's at least then we had the excuse that, you know, the Saudis, man, you know, we don't control the Saudis. But then it's like we fly in there with weapons. Oh, my God, they just fell on ISIS. But you know, we have laser targeting systems and we can pinpoint target, you know, and it's just like, this does nothing makes sense. We're living in this crazy Orwellian world where there is literally bullshit just on our screens every day and we're just like, yeah, swallowing it. So, you know, on the issue of the Kurds, I mean, just be careful. I like it when people clap after I swear. Because my wife is always telling me, you need to stop swearing. And even Dean was like, just don't swear. Please stop swearing. And like, everyone's like, yeah, you said bullshit. So on the Kurd thing, I just want to say that historically, the Kurds have been manipulated consistently by the US foreign policy in relation to Iraq. And that's not to say the Kurds are like, their movement for self-determination is, you know, totally legitimate and I'm all support and that communal effort. But the US has always been using them and then thwarting them and using them and thwarting them. So I don't know, I'm not like an expert in what specifically what's happening with the Peshmerga at the moment. That's
not,
you know.
I'm not an expert either, unfortunately, but what I read is that in Kobane, there's something that is by some writers that I read, even compared to what happened during the Spanish Revolution in the 1930s, that they really tried to, that they're not nationalist Kurds. They adopted some sort of anarchist ideals, and they're trying to build a really radical democracy there with a lot of self-organization and stuff. Yeah. So that would be, I mean, that's what I thought about when there was the question about could the military be a commons? A militia might be a commons. Because there's people, normal citizens, you know, like probably democratically trying to defend themselves against these crazy ISIS attacks that want to make a huge genocide there, basically. And there's so many women fighting. I think the main spokesperson there is a woman, and they had to organize themselves, and they do it in a democratic way, I think.
Well, I think it's interesting how the way in which, if you look at what's happened, it's just in the last 2 weeks, you know, or 2-3 weeks, it's interesting to see how, despite this big coalition and everything, actually, again, you know, the Peshmerga in Iraq have been on the front lines, and the Peshmerga on the Turkey-Syria border have essentially, I mean, they've been calling out for help, and the help hasn't come. Mm. So there are real questions about what on earth we're doing with this coalition and what it's about? Because, and maybe, I mean, that raises some interesting questions because of the complexity of the situation with the Turks and the Kurds, and the fact that the Turks basically do not want Kurdish independence, and they see a danger in the mobilization of the Kurds. And of course, I think for the Brits and the Americans, there is also in that sense, like there are deals being made behind the scenes about what we're going to do with the Kurds and what Turkey has to do to comply and who is going to lose out of that process. So it's complex. It's really difficult to see what the end game is here. And maybe what you're saying about, I wasn't aware of the radical kind of organization that was going on. That's really interesting. Yeah. And maybe
I will show you my
it raises yeah, yeah, yeah. questions about, you know.
Well, I also just want to talk about the importance of independent journalists in covering all of that. And people forming their own media collectives, making their own media, recognizing that the traditional gatekeepers of getting information on all of these issues have either been lying, acting as a conveyor belt for the lies, as with the Iraq War 10 years ago, basically surrounding in the United States, the White House, like a band of wagons to protect their push for war and weapons of mass destruction. That this is a time we see that the media acts hand in hand with the state, and we have to break that relationship. We need a media that covers power, not covers for power. We need a media that is the fourth estate, not for the state, and gives a voice to the people who are organizing on the ground. No matter what you're involved with, media is a key part. Conveying what you're doing has to be a key part of whatever you do to frame it for yourselves. Going back to where we started on the issue of climate change, I was so deeply moved a few years ago when we were in Durban, South Africa at the UN Climate Summit. And it takes a lot to be moved at a UN Climate Summit. Yeah, yeah. You have you have these people that gather, and every year among the officialdom, nothing happens. That's actually part of the point of it, I think. President Obama flew into Copenhagen, basically torpedoed it, and you had Copenhagen, you had Cancun, Durban, Doha, Warsaw, we're going to Lima, we've been to all of these, and then we'll be in Paris. So why bother wasting the fuel to get to these places? But there is a reason. And it's the thousands of people who come from the frontline states, young people who are organizing. For us in the United States, I wanted to reflect the voices of very advanced movements in the rest of the world back to the United States, where it's so mired in money and politics and the oil company money that obfuscates the issues that set up these stink tanks, not think tanks, to make you think it's not true. In the United States, in the media, the most important people to convey this would be the weather people, the meteorologists. You know, they're giving you extreme weather every day, flashing the words extreme weather. What about also flashing global warming and climate change so that people would make connections between these extremely disparate events, you know, forest fires, hailstorms, drought, floods. People can't make sense of it if it's not connected. But when we were in Durban, at the very end of the conference, interestingly enough, I don't know what happened, but young people were allowed to address the conference. And it was a young woman named Anjali Apadurai from a school in the United States that I have also visited in Maine called College of the Atlantic, where you get a degree in human ecology. You know, people were sick of it by then. Officialdom, half of them weren't there. But the hall was packed, and young people came in. And I just wanted to share a few paragraphs of what this young college student said to this mass body that we have played quite frequently on Democracy Now! She stood up, and she said, "I speak for more than half the world's population. We are the silent majority. You've given us a seat in this hall, but our interests are not on the table. What does it take to get a stake in this game? Lobbyists, corporate influence, money? You've been negotiating all of my life. In that time, you failed to meet pledges, you've missed targets, you've broken promises, but you've heard this all before." She said, "We're in Africa, home to communities on the front line of climate change." She said, the International Energy Agency tells us we have 5 years until the window to avoid irreversible climate change closes. The science tells us we have 5 years maximum. You're saying give us 10. The most stark betrayal of your generation's responsibility to ours is that you call this ambition. Where is the courage in these rooms? Now is not the time for incremental action. In the long run, these will be seen as the defining moments of an era in which narrow self-interest prevailed over science, reason, and common compassion. She said, there is real ambition in this room, but it's been dismissed as radical, deemed not politically possible. Stand with Africa. Long-term thinking is not radical. What's radical is to completely alter the planet's climate, to betray the future of my generation and to condemn millions to death by climate change. What's radical is to write off the fact that change is within our reach. And she ended by saying, respect the integral values of humanity. Respect the future of your descendants. Mandela said, it always seems impossible until it's done. So distinguished delegates and governments around the world, governments of the developed world, deep cuts now, get it done. And all the young people in the room stood up. She did a mic check with him, and then they walked out of the room. And the chair of the UN Climate Summit said, thank you, Ms. Apaderai, who was speaking on behalf of half the world's population. And he said, on a purely personal note, I wonder why we let not speak half the world's population first in this conference, but only last. So you'd think that's a kind of official endorsement. And the next year we saw her, and she wasn't inside the conference, she was outside, and I asked her why, and she said, because I've been banned from the conference. Oh. But, is that astounding? But it is this movement that comes out in all different ways. You never know when the moment will come. But if you're involved with social change, and there is a media there, you know, you're the me in the media, that is expressing the voice of the majority. If you're involved with this, you will build a foundation that when that moment comes, you will determine the future. You'll make history.
Joseph, sorry. Talking about the next generation, I wanted to answer to her question. So you were asking... for those who don't see her, I don't know. I guess you are 13, 14 years old? 12. Oh, man. Okay, and you were asking us, your question was, if I remember well, how do we interest the other people in doing the right things, so to say, right? And so my answer would be, it's not about interesting them. It's about being interested in them. So this is what you call an ethos of the commons. And this is how you can really connect to people. It's not about convincing them of the right paradigm and making out of the commons a new ideology precisely. It's about touching their hearts. And you can only touch the hearts of people if you are interested in where do they come from, as Amy already said.
Okay, now it's time for some voices from online.
Hello. Just want to say thank you to everyone who's been following us on Twitter, and this conversation is being echoed very much from everything has been said. There are a few comments and a few questions, but I'll be brief. Madsen says, the price of 4 decades of positive thinking, nice sayings and computing is that depressives are more realistic. Thomas Grimm has a question. Is it enough to just work as or start commons? Is it necessary to transform companies into commons? Any ideas how? I think there was a bit of an answer about co-ops as well, but just so intent. Must clearly state a role play public goods and services, but must only times be flooded with democracy. there was a question that was unfinished by Mirko Nimrod, and it was a question about fear. Are Austrians afraid of Five Eyes attack, not only for more secrecy, surveillance and detention powers, but also speech restrictions? Commonsman asks, how do we shift from a private debt-based money system to a commons-based money system? Antonino D'Ambrosio, who's right here next to us, we need a structural community through commoning. And I'd like to make a personal comment. I think we need to look outwards for these solutions as much as we need to look inwards and be responsible about it, because until greed and selfishness and money and all these superior bullshit failings exist, we are not going to be able to awake and connect to each other as humans. But if we are willing to wake and this understanding collectively and know that this is our choice, you know, be aware is our choice. We can go after these people who are bringing the information. We can, you know, get together and do things. So is our choice also the way we consume? And then maybe, you know, fear can give us a break, because fear is probably half of the issues that are causing all this inequality in the world. And because, for example, if a soldier doesn't want to kill, he's going to make his bullet miss anything alive, you know. And yeah, so that's it. We need to be humble because we're just humans. Thanks.
Silke?
On the economical question thing, how can we transform? Okay. Well, basically, transforming, and I guess I will quote my dear colleague Michelle from Common Strategies Group. The property regime, the governance regime, and the way of production that we already talked about. So I imagine kind of shifting away from the individual property to co-possession, so to say. And there are many different forms. Cooperatives are only one of them. And the cooperatives are not a solution as long as they are not tied to another purpose of production, which is creating commons instead of commodities, which, as we all know, is not easy within a capitalistic world. And we are still in that capitalistic world, so we need to kind of even find models to co-finance this new way of production, perhaps taking out of the market, refinancing the commons. Michelle proposes a commons reciprocity license to do this, just as one vehicle to shape the transition, so to say. And without going into detail, what it definitely needs is two things. One is transparency, transparency, transparency. So open systems, not only in terms of shared information, but also in terms of shared technologies, that is basically open hardware, and commons-based infrastructures. And that is it, commons-based infrastructures. So it is not enough only to share the information, to share the software, to share the design, to make it open and free. But also, and this goes back to the question we had about Airbnb and Facebook, etc., is this sharing? But also, always wondering ourselves, who owns and who reaps the benefit? That is, who really owns the infrastructures which help us to produce the commons for the future? As long as Facebook is the owner and reaps the benefit, we can, at the use level, share the information and cooperate through Facebook. But we don't own it, we don't control it, and we don't reap the benefit at an economical level. So we need to convert that as well. We need to talk about commons-based infrastructures and commons-controlled infrastructures. And this is a neglected issue in that whole debate. I think that even, the geek world doesn't understand the significance of this discussion so far. So, connect the dots. property, shared resources, both in the material world and in the immaterial world, and collective governance model, which can be foundations, trusts, cooperatives, whatever. There are plenty of them out there in the world, based on a commons ethos, which would be like the constitution, actually, of Yoruba. I think that one of the political reasons why nobody really helped the Kurds in Cobain is because there is the commons idea inscribed into their constitution and mode of self-governance. So we should look at the constitution of Yoruba, Yoruba, I don't know how it's spelled, how it's pronounced correctly. So based on this ethos, and for a purpose to produce and reproduce the commons instead of the commodities. And as long as we're doing this in a capitalistic market, so we need to find ways to do the same thing the corporate powers does. The corporate powers, or the market, the anonymous thing, takes out of the commons, reaps the benefit, and makes profit out of our cooperation. So as long as we live in that hybrid world, we need to find ways to hack the institution in such a way that from within the commons, we can take out of the market, reap benefit from what's produced on the market, and make social good and common good out of their commodification.
Can I just add, I mean, I think in terms of making that real, like in terms of getting really real about things, I mean, this is not like, this is, we're having an abstract discussion here, but this is like,
this was too abstract.
This is a reality for, I mean, this is actually ongoing struggles that are happening on the ground in communities. And actually for us in the West, you know, to some extent, you know, we've got our own struggles but to some extent we're really insulated from, you know, what's happening, say, in India or Africa, you know, where you've got people who are facing land grabs. And that's where it gets really real. But, so I think that this is a real struggle. And it's not going to be like, we're just going to waltz in and then corporations are just going to turn, you know, grow flowers and yeah, everything's going to, we would dance on the hills. And I know that was in our film at the end, but it's not going to be like that. It's going to be, I think we have to be serious about, we're going to have to take direct action. You know, we have to think about what it means to basically challenge the existing status quo and to be realistic about what is going to be done in response to those challenges and be ready for that struggle. And it's not going to be easy. And it is probably going to be bloody. And it already is bloody. But I think that just means that it's ever more important to be so grounded in the right ethos and not to be ideological and not to lose sight of what it's all about, you know. But there was one thing, someone said the pessimism thing.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So basically, whoever said, right, pessimism is, I think pessimism is realistic. Like, with respect, that you're part of the problem, mate. Where are you? Who said that? All right, it's online. So, I mean, you're part of the problem because you've just become part of that pessimistic possibility that is in the future. And by saying that that is basically what is real, what will be real, you have contributed to creating that with your apathy. I don't give a shit if there's 99% chance we're all going to burn and die in the apocalypse, because I'm going to stand in the face of that 1% chance and grab hold of it and be like, I'm a freaking optimist, man, because that is all I've got left, right? Do you know what I'm saying? What choice do you have? It's kind of boring to be like, no, yeah, man, pessimism, right? We're all doomed. It's like, that's such a boring response. I mean, like, let's get up and do something. Do you know what I mean? Don't be part of the problem, be part of the solution. Because then, it's like Noam Chomsky said, he actually said that, you know, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. If you are going to be pessimistic about stuff, that's the future you create. So you don't have a choice but to be optimistic. So I would like stare in the face of the abyss and be optimistic about it.
Can I add something? I think the my question of optimism and pessimism is a bit, I mean, I also think that you have to be No, actually, I don't think you have to be optimist. But no, because this is not a spectator sport, right? We're not betting on this team or that team, right? I think if you have a certain freedom to reflect on the world, you have to look where the cracks are, right? So this is the 1%. I mean, if I'm confronted with 99.1%, I'm not optimistic about getting this 1%, but I still hope it will, and try to make out of this 1%, 2%, right? So chances are still shitty, but better. So I think this is our task as people who are privileged to think about the world and are not enmeshed in immediate daily struggles. Because if you're enmeshed in that, chances are that your agenda will be very different for very good reasons, right? So we have this privilege and we have to use it. And to the other question about the economy, I think there are actually very interesting examples of this happening. It's kind of happening in a distorted and weird and contradictory ways. But what we're seeing, for example, in the area of software, is that free software is creating new markets, yes, but these new markets are much smaller than the markets of commodified software they're replacing. And even though I think something like Airbnb is truly evil, it is. But it's still a very strange thing that it shrinks the market, yeah. Right? It produces a lot of things, but it shrinks the market. Mm. So this creates lots of problems for people who, like most of us, who need the market to generate income for survival. But what we're seeing is that a lot of productive capacity is kind of springing out of the institutions of the market, even though they are commodified very rapidly, but they're commodified into smaller and smaller markets. Yes, Facebook is the giant behemoth organizing all of our communication, but it's actually a small company. And given what they do, they're not even that profitable. Mm. I mean, they have a global monopoly on communication, quasi. Mm. Oh, yeah. And they're reaping benefits for a very, very small number of people. So this clearly is not a sustainable model. Or if you look at kind of renewable energy, I think one of the most interesting aspects from a market logic is that if there's lots of wind, energy prices become negative. This is something that markets cannot deal with. So these infrastructures are in place that produce something that makes no sense whatsoever in the market because that's a negative price. So that basically you are paid to consume in a way, which makes no sense. So there are lots of institutions and lots of areas where you see a very complex, enmeshed kind of, yes, there are for-profit companies that put up the wind turbines, and yes, there's IBM using free software. They'll be creating very strange dynamics. I don't think that capitalism will simply kind of innovate itself out of existence, but it won't be that easy. But I think it creates very interesting dynamics that's worth looking very closely to how they work and how we can make sure that they are nudged into one direction rather than the other. And for that task, I don't think that we have to engage in optimism or pessimism or how many percent chances we have of winning. I mean, it's the only thing we can do.
I wanted to come. I wanted to comment just very quickly on the issue that was raised about surveillance. This is a critical issue for us all over the world, and it's even larger than surveillance. It goes to the issue of who has power when you have these powerful states consolidating information on their citizens. And the crackdown on journalists, we see particularly in the United States under President Obama, he's prosecuted more whistleblowers than all presidents combined in the past, and he's going after journalists in a big way, even from the biggest institutions like the New York Times, when the leading national security reporter, James Risen, faces years in prison for not giving up a source, which is part of what we do as journalists, is speak to people, protect their identity, because they have something very important to say. But there's also a bigger issue, and I think it relates to Elevate. Especially here, you've been discussing a lot of technical issues through these days, and you know very well about the effects of surveillance, and you're talking about how to defend yourselves against it. When Glenn Greenwald first came back into the United States, you know, he and Laura Poitras, and Laura's film has just come out in the United States called Citizen Four about Ed Snowden, and that's the name he called himself when he was communicating with her. When they came back after almost a year, fearing that they would be arrested or subpoenaed if they came back in the United States. And so, you know, they came back in on a day they were both winning a major award, a journalism award. So it sort of be hard for the authorities to, you know, haul them away as they were going up on the stage. And then a few days later, they both won the Pulitzer Prize. For their journalism. That's important. That's the hopeful thing. Not these prizes, but that so many people are with them and are deeply concerned, forget about them, but in our own lives everywhere, about how we protect. It goes beyond privacy. When Glenn came back to the United States and spoke at Carnegie Hall, he talked about the studies that show that populations or people, when they feel that they are being monitored, that they when they feel that they're being surveilled, they are less creative. They're more sheepish. They're afraid. And that is what I think everyone has to join together in. No matter what our talents, whatever avenue you pursue, whether we're students or journalists, teachers, techies, employed, unemployed, artists, we have to fight back against that fear. It's where creativity is. I think that's where Elevate is. It's people, you know, conspiring together, talking together, inspiring each other. And that's what we have to fight for. That's why the fight back against surveillance is so important and so much larger than any one of us. It allows us to be together, to talk about what we want to do, what we want to be, what we want to keep private, what we want to share with everyone.
I absolutely agree on pessimism. I suppose they're right, but they won't lead us into a positive world. So I always try to work together with people I feel the optimism with, and actually just with these grassroots movements from the Global South who are really enmeshed in struggles for livelihoods, my experience is that they are very often very optimistic. And this is not because they are more naive and don't know the facts. This is because they feel what Zick calls the common among us. They feel the bond between us. That struggle for life is life, that's how I call it. This feeling you get when you're really not only meeting for a political discussion on one evening in the week, but really enmeshed in it. And one of the points that makes me optimistic is what also had been mentioned, that so many of our discussions, of our thoughts became mainstream common sense, or well-known at least. And I was really surprised when I got to know this week that the president of the Kieler Weltwirtschaftsinstitut, what used to be the most neoliberal institution you could think of when I studied economics, he works very closely together now with Tanya Singer. She's a biologist who works on the brain, and she shows that if we get trained for 1 week in solidarity, our capacity for solidarity already enlarges. And her vision, I think she's well-intended, is that this way capitalism will become a nice one. Well, I think she's also not very good in analyzing capitalism. Because I'm also saying this because there had been the question of how to overcome selfishness. I mean, we've constructed the way we are for hundreds of years, and within 1 week we can change a little bit. This shows the potential in really giving us the opportunity to different experiences. And also in the commons creating peer production, this experiences with peers is so crucial, because this is a point she shows in her work as well, that we are not solidarian with people we don't consider as peers. If they are below us or if they are above us, we are not in solidarity with them anymore. And this is what is happening in this society so extremely in this moment, that it is separating and becomes more and more unsolidarian. And we need to do something, actually, in our daily life against it, I think. And something I wanted to say, but... Ah, yeah, okay. The point that she will not be right, that the capitalism will become a nice one just by doing meditations, brings me to the point Massimo De Angelis does, who I know from the Zapatista movement for a long time, anti-globalization movement, and who works on commons a lot as well. And he says, well, we need a shovel, a shiver, for doing our commons, maybe a very agrarian...
Shuffle,
okay, sir, thank you. Agrarian image, that might be misleading, but okay. We need a shuffle for the commons and to concentrate on how we want to create the society and the economy we want to live in. But it will happen, it will come the point where the shuffle also needs to become a weapon, and this we might be aware of as well.
I don't think that many of you guys are aware how late it already is. So what am I going to do? Everybody's hungry, I guess. And I, as a moderator, don't know what to do. It's kind of tough, because I would love to involve you again, all of you. So I think we'll leave it there. And I hope that you guys will get in touch with each other. I mean, maybe some of you want to make an experiment and just talk to the next person you don't know yet, and maybe you make some new friends. I think that's a first step that we have to do more often to get more powerful as movements and initiatives who really want to make the fundamental changes we need. So thanks, everybody, here on the podium and out there in the internet at the Elevate Media Channel. I think we had a great time, and we're going to continue for one more day tomorrow and tonight in the mountain with some great performances. For example, of Ursula Rucker doing spoken word performances and a lot of music. And tomorrow we'll have a whole day of participation beginning in the in the morning with a lot of cool projects that are presented about security issues in the IT area. And we'll have more participation in the afternoon. You can join us even to think about next year's Elevate edition. We would really like to hear your ideas and get your contributions. So thanks again.
If you have ideas for stories as we go back to the United States and try to create this global community conversation on Democracy Now!, send us ideas at stories, or you can tweet us, but you can send us email at stories@democracynow.org. People to talk to, ideas to cover, communities that we should be more aware of, movements that we should be highlighting. So it's stories@democracynow.org, and I'd love to hear from you. I'll be up here with Dennis.
Can I just say one more thing as well?
You promised that we have a final statement.
Amy Goodman has her book there, The Silenced Majority,
yeah.
Which I could see a colleague was like, Amy, the books.
Yes, because he doesn't want to carry them home.
No. And, you know, and guess what? I've got books too. Woo-hoo.
Oh, my God. And,
yeah.
So be here too.
Yeah, so I don't want to carry mine home either. Like, seriously, like, I had to walk all the way from my hotel. And I've written a novel. And it's called Zero Point. It's a thriller. It's a science fiction thriller of the near future. It's a story of the kind of stuff that we've been talking about. So I'd really love you to come and talk to me about it. But it's my effort to kind of explore different ways of communicating and interacting with an audience. And this is my creative response.
And Sophie, do you have your books available?
Yeah, of course.
Okay, so they're here too.
So we've got three books. So come to the front four. And... Oh.
And you talk to us. Okay.
Talk about rate
yourself.
The only copy I broke of my book I gave to John Holiday. So
we have to download it.
All right. So talk to us. Get your books.
Thank you very
get some
much.
Food. Have fun. See you tomorrow. See you tonight.